Well, amen. I did not bring my offering up here because I knew I was coming up. I was just going to drop it. And so when they came and got it, I hailed them down and gave it to them. But that was good. It's good to see stuff like that. I was trying to figure out how long I would have to pray up here before I could pick all of it up and put it in my pocket. Shows you how much they trust you when they take it off before you get up here. Well, I have certainly been blessed. I've been coming since 2002. I've preached here many times, and I have so enjoyed this conference this week, being with Brother Bill and Brother Rock. I thank God for both of them and Brother Fred. Brother Fred, it's just good to be with you again. I've been around Fred when he was on the mountain. I've been with Fred when he was in the valley. But he's always loved Jesus and always been a blessing to my life. And we'll be together next week, and Brother Bill will be up there. Brother Rock, I'm sorry they didn't invite you, but... But we'll be up in somewhere in North Carolina, not too far from Conover. And so we'll be in a conference there next week. But thank you, Brother Dennis, Brother Jimmy, and others who had a part in inviting me back. And it's been a real, real delight. And I wore purple and gold today because... if a little later in the year you get mad at Alabama, remember I did wear purple and gold for you today. And since you took my offering away, I don't even care. Oh, my. I'm not preaching out of Revelation. I don't know why I even said that. John chapter 20, if you'll turn there, please. John chapter 20. You know, I've been coming so long now, I've preached about everything I know, so I'm having to make stuff up. And when you get down to Humpty Dumpty, you're pretty desperate, I guarantee you. John chapter 20, verse 19. The same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, came Jesus and stood in the midst and saith unto them, peace be unto you. And when he had so said, he showed unto them his hands and his side. Then were the disciples glad when they saw the Lord. And then said Jesus to them again, peace be unto you. As my Father hath sent me, even so send I you. And when he had said this, he breathed on them and saith unto them, receive ye the Holy Ghost. Jesus was crucified on Friday morning at 9 o'clock. He hung upon the cross for 6 hours. He died at 3 o'clock. Not long after he died, Nicodemus and Joseph of Arimathea came and took his lifeless body off the cross and carried it and buried him in a tomb. He was in the tomb all of Friday night, all day Saturday morning, Saturday afternoon, Saturday night. But then in the wee hours of Sunday morning, something wonderful happened. He rose from the dead. He came back to life. We serve a living Savior. And it did not take long for word of that to begin to spread. He's alive. He's alive. He's alive. And can you imagine the joy and the excitement and the thrill those apostles must have felt, those early disciples? He's alive. He's alive. He's alive. My soul. That's the greatest day on the Christian calendar, Easter Sunday. I always loved Easter Sunday, even when I was a pastor. Easter was always the biggest day in the life of our church, and I know there are some who make fun of people who only come to church on Easter, but truthfully, there's not many of those folks left anymore. The truth is, Baptists come to church in shifts. You know that. Some who are here today are not going to be here next Sunday, and then those that are here next Sunday are not going to be here the next Sunday. But Easter is one of those days when they all come, and they all come dressed to their very best, and they all come with an excitement. They come with joy. They come to celebrate the resurrection of the Lord. It is a fun-filled, glorious, exciting day. I don't know how anybody could be sad on Easter Sunday morning. Well, you would think that on that first Easter morning, as those disciples began to hear the word and spread the word, he's alive, the tomb is empty, he's alive again. Well, I tell you, I would have imagined, I would have thought that on that night they would have had the biggest party of history. I would have thought they would have rented a banquet hall, have hired an orchestra, have employed caterers and had the best food, the best music, invited anybody and everybody to come. Tonight we're going to party. Tonight we're going to celebrate. Tonight we're going to have a high old time celebrating the resurrection of Jesus. Why, it just took place this morning. He came back to life. This morning he's alive. And tonight we're going to party. Now, does it seem strange to think that's not why the way it should have been? I mean, you don't have to get Christians too excited to party about anything. And so it just seems like that's the way it ought to be on that Sunday night of that first Easter. But it wasn't like that at all. The verses that I read are of that first Easter night. There had been no banquet hall rented. There had been no orchestra hired. There had been no caterers employed. There was no singing. There was no dancing. There was no shouting. There were 10 men. Thomas wasn't there. Judas had already killed himself. But the other 10, they were huddled in a room behind locked doors, keeping absolutely silent, just hoping no one would find them. I have to tell you, that to me is the most unexpected thing I find anywhere in the Word of God. That morning, their hearts were full of laughter and glee and excitement because Jesus had conquered sin and hell and death and the grave. And that night, in a dark room, behind locked doors, trembling in fear, hoping nobody would discover them, there were those 10 apostles of the Lord. And then Jesus came into the room, and he said some things to them, and we'll look at that in just a moment. But then the Bible says, and he breathed on them. Can I tell you something? And don't get mad with me. I really don't like people breathing on me. There's just something a little distasteful about that. There's something a little bit disturbing about that. Sometimes I'll get through preaching and somebody will come up and, man, they'll just get right in my face, and they've all had garlic. And they'll just breathe all over me. I don't really like people are breathing on me, but you know, when Jesus does it, there's not anything distasteful at all about it. The Bible says he breathed on them and said, "Receive ye the Holy Spirit." Now, he was not inviting them to an experience they'd not already had. These men had already received the Holy Spirit of God. These men were already saved men. These men already had the indwelling presence of the Holy Spirit in their life. But there are days, there are times when you just need a fresh touch of the Holy Spirit of God. There are times when you need a fresh breath of Jesus on your life. And let me take these verses now that I've read and share with you very briefly five times in your life when you just may need a fresh breath of Jesus on your life. Number one, if you have lost the sense of God's presence, you probably need a fresh breath of Jesus on your life. Look what he says in verse 19. Then, the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut where the disciples were assembled. Where the disciples were assembled. Those 10 men, those disciples were assembled. Now, you have to understand about these men. For the last 3 years of their life, they had not been out of the sight of Jesus. They had walked with him. They had eaten with him. They had slept beside him. They had heard him preach every sermon that he ever preached. They had seen him perform every miracle that he ever performed. These men had not been out of the presence of Jesus. But then they had observed his crucifixion, his burial, and now they were here in this room by themselves. And until Jesus walked in, he was not there. They had lost the sense of his presence. Now listen to me. Jesus did say, I will never leave you nor forsake you. And that is absolute theological truth. But sometimes theological truth and practical experience don't always run parallel. Now, Jesus was with them as much as he ever had been, but they had lost the sense of his presence. That happened to David. David in the Old Testament, he was a friend of the Spirit of God. But David sinned. He committed adultery. He had another woman's husband killed on the front line of battle. And because of his sin, David, who was a friend of God, David, who had a heart for God, David lost the sense of God's presence. And in Psalm 51, he cried, O God, take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Cast me not away from thy presence. You see, David, because of sin, had lost the sense of God's presence. It happened to Job. The Bible says several times that Job was a man, he was perfect, he was upright, he escheweth evil, and he feared God. Job was that kind of a guy. And that's not what Job said about himself. That's what God said about Job. He's perfect. He's upright. He escheweth evil. And he fears God. But Job lost everything. None of us have had a life as hard as Job had. He lost everything. He lost his home. He lost his wealth. He lost all 10 of his children. He even lost his health. He became afflicted with a horrible disease. And we find Job saying, oh, that I might find him. He said, I go up and he's not there. I go back and he's not there. I go to the right and he's not there. I go to the left, but he's not there. If I could only find him, I would talk to him and he would hear me. That's what Job said, but he said, I cannot find him. God, where are you? Well, God's where he always was. But you see, life can sometimes be so hard and so cruel that you cannot help but wonder, where's God? Everything is fine as long as the order of service is followed, but when the order of service is broken up and things come into our lives that we did not ask for and we certainly did not want, and yet they come crashing in on us, and we wonder, where's God? Sometimes life itself can cause us to lose the sense of His presence. And if you've lost the sense of the presence of God in your life, you need a fresh breath of Jesus on your life. Number two, if you have come to be gripped by a spirit of fear, you need a fresh breath of Jesus. Look what he said. He said, then the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut, where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews. Now, I don't know many Baptists that are afraid of Jews. And we don't have any reason to be afraid of Jews. They're not our enemy today. But fear is fear. There are some people who are afraid of losing their job. There are some people who are afraid of death. And maybe not so much death itself, but they're afraid of the process of death. You know, sometimes we fantasize about growing old and in good health till we reach 120, and then we lay down one night and go to sleep and wake up in heaven. That's a wonderful fantasy, but that's all it is a fantasy. Some of us in this room will go to heaven because of cancer. Some of us in this room will go to heaven because of a heart attack. Some of us in this room will go to heaven because we're going to be killed by a drunk driver. And so it's that process of death that oftentimes brings us fear. Some people live in fear of losing the things they have. How can I keep food on my table? How can I keep my house mortgage paid up? And fear. Fear is an awful thing. You say, well, Brother Bob, the Bible says God has not given us a spirit of fear, and that's true. But just because God doesn't give it doesn't mean it doesn't still come. And if you have been gripped by a spirit of fear, you don't need a course in self-defense. You don't need to learn the process whereby you have a black belt in karate. If you've been gripped by a spirit of fear, you need a fresh breath of Jesus on your life. Number three, if you are no longer experiencing the peace of God, you need a fresh breath of Jesus. Look what it says there in verse 19 again. Then the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut, where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, came Jesus and stood in the midst and saith unto them, peace be unto you. And that must be a big deal. He said the same thing in verse 21. He said it twice, peace be unto you. If God said something once, that's enough. If he said it twice, that's more than enough. Jesus said, peace be unto you. Do you know one of the greatest byproducts of being saved is being able to experience the peace of God? This world in which you and I live has gone crazy. It's a crazy world. I tell you, beloved, the America that you and I have grown up in does not any longer exist. Mayberry is gone. I'll share this with you, and I'm not recommending this to you. This is not part of the sermon. This is just personal confession. But I had gotten to the point where I would watch the news, and I would get so angry, and I would get so bitter, and I wanted to just go out and hit a Democrat right slap in the mouth. And if I couldn't have found one, a Republican would have done just as good. And it was just causing my guts to churn. And I said, Lord, I don't believe this is how you intended me to live. And he said, son, don't you remember? You're not a citizen down there. My citizenship is in heaven. My name is there. My home is there. Hey, I'm just passing through. And so I stopped watching the news. I haven't watched the news in months. Well, Brother Bob, don't you feel a little ignorant? Ignorance is bliss. I don't belong here. I'm just passing through. I'm on my way to heaven. And I've just decided I'm not going to sit and look and watch at things that are intentionally designed to rob me of the peace of God. And so you don't have to turn off the news if you've lost your experience with the peace of God, but you probably do need a fresh breath of Jesus on your life. I don't know of anything more wonderful for the Christian than the peace of God. It is peace that passes understanding. You can't figure it out. It's that peace that floods your life when the doctor says you have a terrible disease. It's that peace that floods your life when the pink slip is in the envelope that has your salary check in it. Peace, sweet peace, the gift of God's love. But if you've lost the peace of God, and you won't find it in a bottle, you won't find it at the end of a needle. You can only experience the peace of God when you have a right relationship with Jesus and the breath of Jesus, the Holy Spirit of God, alive and at work in your life. Number four. If you have lost your joy, you need a fresh breath with Jesus. Look at verse 20. And when he had so said, he showed unto them his hands and his side. Then were the disciples glad when they saw the Lord. These 10 men that very morning had been singing and shouting and praising and happy and laughter flowing from deep within. These 10 men gripped by fear, missing the presence of Jesus, void of the peace of God, these 10 men had no joy. Do you know why a lot of Christians lose their joy? Because they forgot from whence it came. Hey, our joy as Christians does not come from Sunday school parties. Our joy does not come from green bean casserole dinners. Look what it says there in verse 20. And when he had so said, he showed unto them his hands and his side. Then were the disciples glad. Do you know where your joy came from? Your joy came because one day Jesus stepped out of heaven, came to this earth, took all of your old vile, filthy, wretched, dirty sin upon himself and carried it to the cross and bled and died for you so that your sin could be washed away and the presence of God become a reality in your life. The old song really was right. Jesus, keep me near the cross. They're a precious fountain. You see, the farther away a person gets from the cross, the less joy they have. Our joy comes from his hands and his side. And if you've lost your joy, you don't need to go home and watch the comedy channel on television. You just need a fresh breath of Jesus on your life. One last thing, number five. If you have lost your passion to serve the Lord, you need a fresh breath. Look what he says there. In verse 21, he says, peace be unto you, as my Father hath sent me, even so send I you. You see, Jesus said, with the same commission that the Father gave me to leave heaven and come to earth, with that same commission, so send I you. What did the Father commission Jesus to do? He commissioned Jesus to come to the earth and be a servant. Jesus said, the Son of Man did not come to be ministered unto, he came to minister. He came to serve. The disciples did not wash his feet. He washed their feet. And with that same commissioning, he sends us out. He sends us out to be servants. I know a lot of pastors who see themselves as CEOs of an organization. They see themselves as business administrators. But I want to tell you, if you're a pastor called by God, he's commissioned you to be a servant. And sometimes we lose that passion to serve. I've had pastors call me, Brother Bob, will you recommend me to this place? Will you recommend me to I don't do that very often, I have to be honest, because if you recommend a guy, you hit your star with him, and if he falls, you go down with him. But at times, I don't mind doing it if I think everything's right. But sometimes pastors are so desperate. Brother Bob, you just don't know. You don't understand. I've got this woman in my church. Brother Bob, she hates me. She hates my wife. She hates my children. And Brother Bob, she never misses. She never gets sick. She never goes to visit anybody. She's there every Sunday morning, every Sunday night, every Wednesday night, in this intersection, four rows back. And she comes in, sits right in front of me, and she folds her arms and cocks her head and grits her teeth, and Brother Bob, I can't take it. I just can't take it. I can't take it anymore. Finally, a pulpit committee comes and he moves. And his first Sunday in his new church, he goes to the pulpit and there sits her sister. There's not any shortage of heifers, they're everywhere. Now, if that offends you, get over it. As soon as I get through preaching, I'm heading for the airport, all right? You see, it just may be that what you need is not a new church. It just may be that what you need is a fresh breath of Jesus on your life. Jesus breathed on them. Have you lost the sense of God's presence? Have you become gripped by a spirit of fear? Are you no longer experiencing the peace of God? Is the joy you once knew now gone? Have you lost the passion serving the Lord? I recommend to you, let Jesus breathe on you today. And he breathed on them and said, receive you the Holy Spirit. That sweet, blessed filling of his Spirit. The filling of the Holy Spirit is not always accompanied by noise. Not always accompanied by singing or preaching. Usually it's just that little fresh breath of Jesus on your life. Would you bow your heads right there where you are? These other two men are going to come, and I'm sure that both of them or one of them will give a public invitation. But right there where you are, if you would be honest enough to just tell the Lord, Lord, I sure do need a fresh breath today. Jesus, would you breathe on me right now, right here? Lord, just breathe on me. Fill me afresh with your Holy Spirit. Lord, I receive him afresh. I have no blockades. I have no desire to keep him out. Jesus, just breathe on me. I receive that fresh infilling of the Spirit of God. Would you just sing that little chorus that she's playing? Holy Spirit, breathe on me. Brother Fred will lead us in that chorus. Will you sing? Let this be a prayer.
Breathe on me.